thank you everyone for coming to Mitchell Giddings Fine Arts once again to support all the wonderful arts and all the wonderful artists. Before I make my introductions tonight, I just would like people to know that in conjunction with a monthly Brattleboro West Arts meeting, we're having our Brattleboro West Arts meeting after this particular presentation. So at approximately 6 o'clock, the members that are here who have brought some potluck food are going to be scrambling to set it up and to eat. And others are welcome to look around, ask questions, but that will be going on. And fairly soon after that, we'll be sitting down for our meeting and our supper. So that's how we've scheduled it this particular time. So again, thank you all for coming. And as I said before, thank you for supporting Mitchell Giddings Fine Arts. This is a special afternoon, long in coming, even as the time has flown by at warp speed, for this is our recognition of co-founder Petria Mitchell's beautiful imaginary landscape paintings and her opportunity to tell her story about her artwork. I say co-founder, but really the weight she has borne for the creation of her vision and the labor since opening is way more than most people know of or could bear. And I've read this 15 times every single time. It is also crazy making, overwhelming, and relentless. That she can carve out time for painting makes this exhibit even more special. Not only do the paintings sparkle with the same sensitivity to touch and mood with which we're familiar, but the amount of work she offers would make most of us other painters envious. This is a wonderful accomplishment, and it is our good fortune that David Holzapfel has agreed to lead us for a close look into Petey's art world. David has been a furniture maker, more of an artist with wood, really, for 40 years, finding and nurturing the beauty in those trees, usually left behind by loggers because of their quirky or non-commercial personalities. David has been a teacher, more of an artist with pupils, really, for 40 years, finding and nurturing the beauty in those students lucky enough to share his classes. David was recently recognized for his exceptional efforts with the Vermont Humanities Council Teacher of the Year Award for 2015. So I welcome David. Thank you so much for helping us, and Petey. Thank you all.
Well, thank you all for coming out this afternoon. I'm sure that we've all seen TED Talks. And when I've looked at TED Talks, I'm just amazed at how well those speakers are able to talk in brilliant sentences with no notes. They've got facts and figures and information in their heads, and I'm just thinking that's incredible. And then I realize they've got teleprompters. No one here at Mitchell Giddings was willing to install them. They would have been right across there, behind you all. And so I'm going to use very ancient, but up to the 20th century, through the 20th century, item called paper. On the paper, I have marks and symbols that I'm going to read. So we are very fortunate to have this opportunity to join Petey in conversation about her work today. The paintings we see on the wall around us could be regarded as the sum total of Petey's life to date. It would, of course, be silly for us to enter into this totality with the belief that we could plumb its depths. We've only got a couple hours today, and it's taken Petey 50-some years to get here. Pardon me if that's an exaggeration. So we'll have to content ourselves with glimpses into the work and into Petey's creative life to shine a light on them so that we may see them more clearly. Petey invited me to serve as interlocutor this afternoon, so I've developed a number of questions, including those of biography, process, technique, and content, to use as a general outline for our discussions. I'd like to propose a format for our collective conversation. The intent, given our limited time, is to enable us to take a broad look at a number of issues regarding Petey's work. I'll ask a question or raise an issue. Petey will respond, and then I'll open the floor to a follow-up question, possibly two, before we move off that specific topic. The hard part for you all, and possibly frustrating, will be that your follow-up question needs to be based on what Petey has just said, and not a different topic. You may, if you have a piece of paper and something to write with, and have a burning question that we have to skip over, there'll be time intervals through the course of the afternoon where you'll be able to speak those questions and then at the end as well. It's my hope that this format will engender an encompassing view into the work, because collectively we can be more insightful than any one of us alone. We're not likely to exhaust the range of questions we have. And for some, there might not be any follow-up questions, so don't feel pressure to come up with one if nothing occurs to you. I'm going to begin with biographical questions to help with the larger context of your work. I'm guessing most of us in the room would say, yeah, I know Petey, but do we actually know how much of the story that got us here today? So we'll begin at the beginning, having to do with when and where were you born, and where did you spend your earlier years?
I don't remember when I was born. But I'm working on that. I was born in Greenwich, Connecticut in 1956, and wasn't there for very long. Mom and Dad moved to Suffern, New York when I was 6 years old. But I do remember parts of Greenwich and Benny Park and places like that. But Suffern, New York is where I lived until I was about 16. Mm-hmm. And then went on from there. Do you want me to move on from there?
Well, yes, we'll get there. But okay. How would you describe yourself as a child?
Very loving, very independent, a free thinker, and didn't want to listen to elders.
Oppositional disorder.
Oppositional disorder.
I'm curious about when artistic practice entered your life. And some of my questions are going to be like clusters. So I don't want you to be thinking that you need to answer each of them, but rather they're going to be sort of questions around an issue. So my question is, when did artistic practice enter your life, and from whom did you receive early instruction or encouragement?
I remember started seriously painting when I was six. And that was really my way of keeping myself company. There weren't a lot of siblings around, and I spent most of my time in the woods and along brooks and just playing with amphibians and birds. And so I guess you would characterize me as having been a lonely child, not an only, but a lonely one. And what was the other part of the question?
Having to do with who were some
of the people? Some influences when I was young.
Well, who encouraged you? Yeah. Said, hey, this is good.
My mom and dad. Mm-hmm. They really, really trusted, even though I really didn't want to be in school, in high school, that I was really immersing myself in creating, whether it was drawing or painting or sculpting. And Mom and Dad really supported that. They were questioning and wondering, why is this such a big focus? Because they really wanted me to concentrate on what they considered normal upbringing and schoolwork, which I would not adhere to, which is not a great thing. But so Mom and Dad, uh-huh. Yeah.
And then with regard to formal schooling, art training, where did you attend school, and who were some of your important teachers? This is a big one. And some of the influences in the realms of your art practice. And if possible, something about what you learned from them or what you feel you incorporated into your own practice.
I left high school and went to the National Academy in New York when I was really young, and that was an adventure. I was 16, I think, when I started taking a bus from Suffern 5 days a week and met a lot of really interesting people. So let's say Daniel Green and Tania Labrandi and other people that were around the National Academy. Joseph Hirsch was a huge influence in my life. He was so encouraging. He was like a daddy figure. And the people that were at the National Academy, all of them were very supportive of me because I was one of the youngest ever allowed or accepted on portfolio to go to the National Academy, which, so they were all very protective. Most were very protective, especially when I was studying human anatomy and the first time I saw a naked man, they were seeing my response to it, and I was just, I couldn't believe it. It was amazing. So, but they were very protective, and it was a wonderful, wonderful part of my life, which I wished I stayed in New York a lot longer than I did. Mm-hmm. But so, I think Joseph Hirsch just had a huge influence on me. And again, my dad did, because my dad was a woodworker and a boat builder and a photographer. And so, but did I answer your question?
Did she?
Did I answer the question? Because my brain started going just a whole mile a minute in another direction.
Anyone else have a question?
Influences? Boy, Diebenkorn, one of the biggest ones, really. Monet, Manet, Picasso. But really, I would say Diebenkorn, Rothko. And Monet really were the ones that really had a huge influence on me back then. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I guess, was there a point when you realized that you were going to devote your working life to artistic practice? Or maybe you haven't arrived at that point yet.
Oh gosh, when I was going to school in New York and I would be solo going around to all the museums and all the galleries, I said to myself, wow, this is a world that I feel that I'm already part of to a certain degree, that I'm being creative. I'm not part of that marketing, that retail world. I didn't even understand what that meant. But I felt very comfortable among in that atmosphere. I don't know how to answer that question.
Well, I mean, there's
reframe it.
And gradual enlightenment. They're both, you get to the same place, but the way they manifest is different. So there may not have been an epiphany that you thought, oh, I'm an artist.
No, I don't think that there was an epiphany. It's just, it's always been kind of an assumption that I've worked with and love hanging around other creative people and having that support what I'm doing. But maybe it was different because I had such support from mom and dad to leave high school and go that it felt, oh, okay, so if they say that that's an okay thing to do and the people at the National Academy were just so supportive that I felt support. Mm-hmm. That was a direction that I really wanted to go. How it would manifest itself, I really had no idea what kind of schooling I would. Well, I went on to the Vesper George School of Art in Boston and lived in Boston for a while after that. And that was a really interesting experience too, but there were more people at least that were 18 or 19 years old. So I was around some peers at that point. I don't remember too many of the instructors back then. That was a lot of studio practice, strictly studio practice at Vesper George back then, which I don't even think still exists, but yeah.
That was good because you kind of moved in. When did you end up in Vermont? How did that happen?
Oh gosh, I was living upstate New York doing engravings and etching, actually.
Give us a year-ish?
Oh, it was 77, 78, when I moved here with my first husband. And that is when we had to sell the etching press because there were a lot of allergies with him. So I had to stop doing original prints. So that was, so I went into engraving, which was on mammoth ivory, people call scrimshaw, which I did on the show circuit for many, many, many years, and just actually stopped doing it after 30, almost 40 years. But so I moved here and moved to Putney, to right next to Joe Familari's place, across from Mac and Claire Oglesby, is where I first landed in 78. And that was a wonderful place with no running water and just right at home. Electricity, though, an outhouse.
What was the show circuit? What are you referring to?
Which you know the circuits really well. The Sunapee craft shows all over the country, ACC shows, and did that for, oh golly, I guess 20 years. Yeah. Yeah. And, well, a lot more shows than that.
I didn't get the word you used about the engraving. You did some sort of engraving?
Oh, scrimshaw?
Scrimshaw.
Yeah, okay. That's a term that historically engraving into different kinds of ivory was referred to as scrimshaw. Yeah, and I did that on large, whether small pieces or large artifacts, that fossilized walrus ivory or mammoth ivory, 10 to 30,000 years old, and I did craft shows, juried craft shows all over the country. And that was a good way to cut my teeth on retail and working with the general public and collectors. And that was hard work and going from show to show to show to show to show for many years, but that was what I did.
Process, technique, and content, or does anybody have any comments or questions with regard to biography? Okay. Process, technique, and content aren't easily separated, but I'm going to make an artificial distinction for the purposes of this discussion. So with regard to process and technique, I have some questions about your workflow. I want to be able to see what worked while not actually being there. So this first cluster question is, when and how do you create? Like, do you have a set time allotted for painting, or certain times of day for certain painting tasks, or whenever you feel the call, or you have a deadline, or how do you know when it's time?
All of the above. Mm-hmm. I work a lot under deadline. Most of my paintings are delivered wet, which is not good. There's a lot of organic materials on the surface lots of times. But my favorite time to paint has always been, or create at all really, is pretty much, let's say 1 o'clock in the afternoon to as much as 9 o'clock at night. I save the beginning of the day being outdoors and doing office work, so I kind of struggle between those two. Home time and office is always before I go into the studio and start creating. I love the in between 2 and 5. I don't know why. That's just my rhythm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, even in the winter. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This again, a cluster. Do you paint outside or for memory indoors, or do you use photos as reference? None or all of the above, or some other means?
The first part, I used to do a lot of painting outdoors. I don't anymore. I'm a studio painter and I sketch. I start with thumbnail sketches that are just starting from an abstract reality, really. They're very, very, very abstract. That's how I start, actually. They're quite abstract, and then they might become, or do, become more representational, but I would rather have it be more abstract. But anyway, I start with thumbnail sketches, always. That's what I've always done. Mm-hmm. When I'm working towards a show, I'll just make a grid of a lot of squares or rectangles, depending on or whatever orientation I might want, and just start doing lines and just see how they merge and how they intersect diagonals. And mm-hmm. and that's how I get started. And what was the rest of your question? That was a cluster.
That was a cluster. So I thought that was good.
To answer some of it?
I'd say some to most in that case.
Good.
Yeah. I'm wondering.
I was curious, Petey, whether your thumbnails are oil paintings or sketches, or you know, pens or pencil or charcoal.
They're usually pen. Yeah. Yeah, because my eyes are changing so much. I used to work in pencil, but I really need to see the contrast right away. Sometimes felt tip, but generally just a ballpoint pen. Yeah.
with regard to your oils, do you mix them on a palette or board, or directly on the canvas or paper, and or both or neither?
Both, and I work with a pretty limited tube palette. I mix most of my own colors, which can show there's a lot of variation in the surface of many of my paintings. But I don't create my own color, but I use a very limited, like maybe 7 colors. Mm-hmm. And then all of what I work with comes from that. Mm-hmm. So let me see, and sometimes I start with, and many in this show, are started with a warm underpainting that is sometimes workable, sometimes not. I like it to be workable. I work with a medium that's 3 parts, Damar varnish, linseed oil, and terps. And I want to keep it workable. And that's why they're always wet, because I like edges. So I'll start with something that might be still workable with a very hot color or a very cool color, and then jump in right there with the basic outlines of what I'm working with, and then do the darkest first, and then jump in.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
What do you mean by workable when the underpainting is workable? What do you
meaning mean? It's still not stiff, it's still wet, so I can have the next layer work in with it.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Jim.
I mean, the thing is, I have no idea what she's talking about. She could be not telling us the truth here, and I'd just be, okay. Okay, go ahead.
Do you paint a la prima all at once, or do you go to paintings over several days?
So the one piece or several pieces? Or
no, like you did like the painting behind you or anything. Do you do that painting all in one session? Or you let something dry and go back in and make adjustments?
It all depends. I really don't like it when it starts to dry, because then I can't seem to make the edges meld, because I love when the edges are able to be soft generally and meld or make it a nice greasy edge so it's soft. But sometimes, like the smaller ones here on these walls, they're done relatively quickly. They're done maybe over maybe 5 hours, and that might not be the same sitting, but I'm making it so there's enough linseed oil in it so it stays workable. Workable gem. In other words, I can still work it. move the paint around.
Able to be worked, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I can still move the paint around.
How long does the paint remain wet? I mean, do you have a couple of days? Do you have 12 hours?
A couple of days. Yeah, and I used to work with a lot less oil and a lot more terps, and that would make some of the darker colors sink and would make it so they would really dry, and I would have to start with a whole new layer on top of it. That's why some of these, you'll see, they have lots of layers, and some seem quite transparent, like the big one. The most of the orange ground was done very quickly, but that one has lots of layers, so it would dry, and then I would have to go in and put a whole new layer with wanting to continue with that painting.
You've explained that you make preliminary sketches, or rather, it sounds like they're not so much preliminary sketches as ideas that you're just generating, and then do you select from what you see in your grid and then decide, yeah, this is worth pursuing? How do you decide mm-hmm. what you're going to paint?
Yeah, yeah, that's mm-hmm. how I do it. Yeah, and the more exciting did somebody say something? The more exciting the composition, then I'll want to grab that one first, the one that has more activity in it. But yeah, because they're so not precious that it's just so much fun to just start an idea with those and then choose from those. Yeah.
Particularly on larger pieces that, as you say, will take several days, do you work on other things also, or do you tend to, I guess in a sense that was in part your question, do you work on one piece at a time, or you're working on this, but you've got these three small ones that you're working on, will you leave this and go work on those a little bit, or will you stay focused on one at a time?
I generally work on maybe two or three at one time, depends on the size. These two on the end walls are a little bit large for my studio, so I'll work on maybe one of them and one smaller one at the same time. It's nice to be able to use, to keep a, I like to try to keep a consistent palette when I'm working on those, although these guys are a little bit different. But when I have a large amount of paint out, I would like to use it and get something going with it. So starting more surfaces is a good idea. But I don't work on five or six at one time.
Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
What do you mean by a large amount of paint? And also, what do you mean when you say not precious?
Large amount of paint is just because I mix everything myself. I don't add up a tube and then it's ready to work. Mm-hmm. I don't do that. There might be a puddle about this large.
Mm-hmm. Well, from, I knew it could be a cup of paint, so I didn't
know. Oh, no. Mm-mm. No. And the second part of your question was?
What do you mean by precious or not precious?
Precious meaning I'm not needing to cling to it, that it's okay whatever happens to it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I love keeping them, and sometimes I'll take the sketch and put it on the back of the painting so somebody sees how that painting was started. And that's a fun thing to do. There's an intimacy, see the paper trail of how it started and how it ended.
Though I imagine it would be, well, what goes on in your head
when?
While you're painting?
It depends on which part, because there's a lot of intellectual thinking of getting the palette going, and but then there's the time of just getting very, very involved in the creative process and just letting the muse do what it wants to do. In my artist statement, and which is not really completely finished, but it's a different way of me talking about my work, that there's a lot of fear for me because I'm going into the unknown and not knowing. There's part of it's the preciousness of not really wanting to mess up and screw up, and a lot of artists are going, yeah. It's hard to get beyond ruining another surface using more cadmium paint that costs $40 a tube. So there is, there's a certain amount of fear that I'm actually starting to have fun with now. That I'm just saying, okay, whatever emotion seems to really come in, pay attention to it, and it's getting to be a really fun game now. So,
do you listen to music?
I do. I listen to a lot of Mozart, a lot of classical music, and also, not lately, but a lot of Buddhist teachers, their teachings. I really enjoy. It's really wonderful while I'm painting. Mm-hmm. But in between, or a book on tape, or somebody reciting poetry. but yeah, classical music, yeah. And the only time I can really listen to words, if somebody's singing words, it's harder for me. But if they're giving, let's say, a teaching, then I'm paying attention to it differently.
Does it happen that a piece will get started and you'll get to a certain place in it and then abandon it for whatever reason or become uncertain about what needs to happen next? Or how does that work? How does your, yeah.
Probably 70% of the time. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that I have to just go, ugh, and then turn it towards the wall and just leave it. The contradiction is that I want the paint to be workable. So there's a lot of pressure. So there's quite a few paintings in my studio that aren't finished that will have to end up having the second layer. But the ones that feel very successful to me are the ones that stayed workable and that were very fresh, and the edges just melded really well, and the color was cohesive, and yeah.
So how do you know when a painting is done?
And the paint's stiff, no.
when the check is cleared?
Yeah, right. Gosh. Well, it's an intuitive thing, really. And when it's done, that's when one of the fun part for me, when I know or I'm close to done, that's when I take my finger and go, and you'll see cuts in the surface. It looks almost like maybe like scratches. That's kind of like, okay, yeah. How do I know that? It's just an intuitive, when the colors and the shapes seem balanced and the light seems workable. It's interesting when the market was very hot, when the paintings would go out to a gallery, they generally would never come back. It's so interesting seeing things that paintings that I maybe had worked on or did create maybe a year before that or 2 years before that, I want to go back in and correct something. So they might be done for the moment. You know, my wish is that they feel cohesive and done and resolved visually. But that's not always the case. But I do leave a lot of them behind, mm-hmm. Yeah. And maybe after they're really, really dry, after a few years, I really want to reuse the surface and gesso over it again over many years and then use the surface again.
Right.
Yeah. Again, the waste thing.
Jim, come on, man.
Oh, no.
Yes.
I knew these painters
I'll get to you, Jim. Yes, ma'am.
Petey, can you talk about how you see the light that is in your paintings?
How
you see the light that is in your paintings?
How do I see it?
How do you identify it, find it, see it, capture it, put it on there?
Again, that's just an intuitive thing. The light is a big part of what gives me a lot of joy, that I feel very connected to, I think probably most painters do, or artists. So,
it's a pretty abstract question. I just wondered if you could talk about that.
It's the first thing I think about in relation to starting a piece, because I'm starting with the opposite. I'm starting with the darkest values. So I am really conscious of how much light I really want to have come through. And that's one of the reasons why I like to use, especially lately, a lot of warm colors in an underpainting, or at least areas of the painting, so that comes through. So the light is always something that's my right on the first three or the first two things I'm thinking about when I'm creating a piece.
Yes, Jim.
Petey and I went to South Pond about 3 or 4 weeks ago, just at dusk, so that Petey could just absorb the way the light was playing off the clouds and the water. And I don't think that really is exactly what you were talking about, but the sense of light and how it infuses that particular painting has always been important, and I've always enjoyed that. I had a question. I just want people
to know. That wasn't your question?
Well, not a question. No, I'm
moderator.
I'm not going to take that from you. I'd like people to know how much and how successfully Petey tweaks her work. She's talking about making changes when the paint is wet. I work very differently. I say.
We got your question. Thank you, sir.
I don't know.
Would you repeat your question?
I don't know what the question was.
When the question mark that you have there, that's the end of the question.
How beautifully she can tweak it and make significant change with minute movement of the paint.
Okay.
So she's constantly critiquing and making those changes while the surface is wet.
So that was a statement, not a question.
Yes.
You can just say yes or no to that.
I like it.
I'm going to try it.
I will hit some, you, madam, and then you. Go ahead. You know, and listening to Petey, and you talk about starting with a, you know, tweaking something in front of you, and then these are so the natural world, and yet, is it, I get the feeling, like, I couldn't go somewhere and see that particular.
This is a very important point you're making, and we'll get to that very shortly. Yeah, you raise a very good point, and we'll get to that in a moment. I'm sorry to, we'll come back to it, and if, when we do, you're not satisfied, please put your hand up again. Yes.
And I'm wondering, Petey, back to the sketch stage, if the sketch is based on an image where you've been, or if sometimes it's pure imagination.
They're just they're abstract compositions, yeah, that seem to refer to something having to do that turns into water or maybe tree. And I go back and forth in between being tighter, more representational, and then more abstract. I'm more comfortable with abstract work, but when I'm, okay, I'm gonna contradict myself. When I'm nervous and I'm working towards a show, I might lean more towards, I don't know if I'm answering your question, more towards working from something that's very known to me, in other words, that I can see, or draw a tree, something rather than something that's abstract. But then once I get past that fear, which is usually pretty fast, then it's I feel like I'm comfortable where I am, which is something that's more abstracted.
So in some respects, this brings us into content. How did you come to landscape as your primary subject of investigation? What other subject matter have you painted, or do you paint in addition to landscape?
I'm being within landscape every single day, several times a day, living around a lot of trees and a lot of water. I feel the most connected to myself spiritually when I'm working with something that has reference to landscape. So that's really where I started when I was really young. And the shapes, they're limitless. I mean, there's so many shapes to work with, so much color to work with, that going in and out of a focus of whether that is actually representational of something that's landscape or not is really fun to mess with. And George O'Keefe had a huge impact on me when I was about 15 to 20. Mm-hmm. Just seeing what she did with the Jack in the Pulpits, that, yeah, okay, then, whew, then you just go right to the Jack and, oh, what really is that? Yeah.
Often landscape paintings include humans or evidence of human activity or animals. Such human references can conjure the sublime or assist the viewer's entry into the work. Personally, I confess to seeking people or buildings in your work, and even to conjure them up sometimes through some of your brushwork. But it makes me wonder, do you regard your paintings as landscapes in the traditional sense? How does your work fit within the genre of landscape, if you think it does?
I think it fits in with the genre of landscape in this time we live in, because I'm here and I'm responding to it, to landscape and color and light and form. That's a hard question to answer. Good. Does anybody have any hints?
Okay, well,
yeah, you can
we
ask
have,
it in
we
a
have
different
some
way.
Other questions, and we'll see if we come back around to that. How about this? Would you say something about the relationship between your inner and outer landscapes?
Well, that's interesting, because the pieces that are very emotional, these two very indigo-esque, very atmospheric pieces are, I was in a lot of pain when I painted them, and I was not satisfied with what I was doing, but I said, Pete, just let it go and then go back in and go back in. This is my, this is a manifestation of my internal landscape. These particular pieces, and they were wet when I brought them in, they're really meaningful to me because there's a lot of sadness saying goodbye. And, you know, in Buddhism, clinging, a lot of clinging in these paintings. And then the brighter ones are brighter, are not to say that's not, I mean, there's optimism within sadness for me. I feel like I'm a walking contradiction all the time. But I'd rather feel my emotions than not. I'm really glad that I'm right there with it. So I think that there's a lot of traveling and movement in probably all of them. None of them are really static. There's movement of taking you somewhere that, or myself or someone else that might be experiencing it, going somewhere that they really don't know where they're going and being okay with that. And that pretty much is a metaphor for my life of just keep on going and try to see what's up there. So these, whether they're what some people might refer to as somber colors, like in these, actually these two, and that one in the end. Yeah, I'll just leave it at that. I think I answered the question.
Mm-hmm. Question about, you described how from the get-go you were doing landscapes as a kid. How hard was it to stick with that when you were in New York City and Boston for long periods of time? Because obviously there are trees and there are parks in those cities, but there's a whole bunch of other influences as well. So did you still just stick with it? Or?
When I was in New York, I was doing strictly the human form, which I probably should have said, because I was studying the human form in anatomy. Even my painting, I was doing a lot of drawing, but my paintings were all of human beings back then in New York and some buildings. So I guess I was responding to all the humans. But what was interesting, when people got up in anatomy class, there was so much diversity. I was a kid that was from the country then, and seeing all these different kinds and shapes of people that would get up and, of course, take their clothes off. Some were had garments, but I was really immersed in the complex diversity of what the human form had to offer when I was in New York.
Let's speak briefly about scale. Scale and the related viewing distance are also important for you and for the viewer. For most of your career, you've worked on a small scale, but in recent years, you've scaled up, so to speak. What are some of the factors that caused that change in your scale?
I actually was doing larger work many years ago, too. I was doing a lot of murals. Or several murals, shouldn't say a lot, but there was a phase where using a brush this wide was just, and still is really exhilarating to do that. Again, of course, when I get past the fear of using so much paint, when I'm going larger scale, that is still something that I think about. But once I get beyond that, I love doing large work. I absolutely love it. Getting away from choosing not to work with a lot of detail in larger surfaces is really gratifying, very freeing also. And I can see the shapes, I guess I won't say more easily, but it's such a different experience working large. And I wouldn't even call these guys really large. I would love to work if my studio, that's why going outside would be a good idea. Doing something that would be 8 feet by something would be really intriguing to do that.
And in terms of the viewer's experience, how do you see the smaller scale work being different for the viewer than larger scale? Or is that not a consideration as you're working?
It's not really a consideration. They're little gems to me. They're the little people that might grow up into something that's a lot bigger, maybe. But I don't consider them sketches. So I don't know how people perceive them. Maybe they're, I don't feel that they're more accessible or not.
Well, I guess I'm thinking about the intimacy of them. But I don't want to answer your question, or my question.
Whether I feel that they contain more of an intimacy than the larger pieces?
Yeah. I mean, maybe that's obvious, but...
Well, the smaller pieces are, at least for me, this group, are under glass, so there's a barrier. And then there's other barriers, so you're not right on. And that does make it more precious. It does seem almost gem-like, because they do have... these containers, there's the mat underneath, there's the glass, there's the frame, as opposed to these guys, just a very simple profile frame. Oh, that's making me think about things differently. I don't know. I would love to know people's response to the little guys, as opposed to the little people, as opposed to the larger ones.
Michelle?
It's a very visceral difference for me that painting that gets to be larger than I am, kind of, I have to stand back to see it. And as you say, these smaller ones, like, I can get right up next to it, and I'm always aware that I'm so much bigger than it. And it kind of makes a difference, like, right in the middle of my body, of whether something's bigger than me or whether it's smaller than me, the way I relate to it.
Does that mean that the smaller ones make you feel more comfortable?
No, or? I think in a way they seem more like something I could cherish and take care of. A bigger one is a little bit more like a peer, and even bigger than a peer.
Really in your face,
You know, just and what I enjoy is the sort of visceral difference between large and small.
Yes, ma'am.
I find that the large ones really draw me in. I feel like I can be part of them. I can walk into them and feel them as if, I'm looking at that one. That happens to be one I can see the best from here, and I feel like I'm a part of that landscape. The little ones, as you say, are much more precious and gem-like. And there's a distance, this barrier. I can enjoy them, and they're beautiful, but these I have a different experience with. I can really move into them. These, your darker ones, there's a barrier. It's as if you're saying, yes, enjoy them, and, you know, this is what I've done, this is what I feel, but this is mine, not yours. Does that make sense?
In other words, the darker ones?
The darker ones.
That's interesting.
That the others are so expansive and so inviting that you can be part of it, but the two darker ones, these two anyway, are walling you off. You say, here, I'm sharing this with you, but don't get too close. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense to you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's neat.
this is just coming out of many of, you know, different things strike people differently. Mm-hmm. The feeling that I get from the big ones is that they're, from the brighter ones, they make me want to go inside. I feel like exactly the opposite of that. It's the dark ones that draw me in, and the brighter ones kind of don't.
That's what's so neat about
it. It is.
Yeah.
It's what, I mean, you're definitely doing your job, because you're putting us all through our paces.
Oh, I love it.
Yeah. I actually thought of, because I know that these were very, very different, and I said, okay, am I going to be brave enough to show the struggle and the density within myself and the fear and show these paintings? And I said, it's all there. It's fine. But thanks, Mariette. I love hearing that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I just would like to draw attention to the painting that's opposite the two of you, which is hard for a lot of us to see, but I think it's a combination in a way of both, because we've got the bright sky and the bright water, and so somehow we're allowed in or drawn, but there's this darkness too, and to me that's one of the most successful pieces here. It has extraordinary composition, and we're in kind of a mystical place. It has all the power and energy of the darkness that you refer to when you talked about how emotional those two pieces are. But the brightness is there too. And in a way, I think it feels sort of like you've resolved some of those questions yourself. I'd be interested in your comment about how you feel about that painting.
It's what started this whole, it's one of the main pieces that started this traveling and not knowing where you're going series. and I think there is a lot of optimism and question also, because of the color of the ground has a lot of warmth in it, as opposed to these are very cool. So I think it is kind of it's a contradiction, but it's also a combination of what's being said here, that this is the in-between painting. And I think I love it because of that, and I haven't messed with it. I haven't really wanted to mess with it a lot, which is good. Thanks, Steve.
In this work, we see ample evidence of the elements of earth, air, and water. Fire often enters through the skyscape or by way of a fiery sky reflected in water. How have the specific features of your landscapes evolved over the years?
How have they evolved?
Yeah, in other words, the element of land itself. Who can help me explain
old,
this better?
They're old geology, not new geology. They're soft landscapes compared to rugged landscapes.
Oh, because there's not rock? Is that what you mean, specifically?
Of course that's what he means.
It's the only thing it could mean.
Actually, I was thinking more about your scrimshaw and the surfaces of old bone, old ivory, and how these shapes remind me of that. So when you're talking about types of land, I see these as very old landscapes.
And soft. You know, and maybe that's rounded. So is the style of landscape that we're seeing now, has that been what you've been, I mean, everyone's different, but each work is different, but has that generally been the way in which you've been working, or have there been more crisp delineation of form?
I think the compositions and either a really low horizon line or a very high horizon line, and a lot of rivers and things. That's been a real constant. I did an analysis of over the last 30 years of looking at how many times I just love to just stick with what I'm doing. But the paint has become much looser, and that's something that I'm really enjoying. I would work smaller and then would be because scrimshaw, I was doing scrimshaw and painting at the same time. So there was just this breathing where it would be very tight, charging per square inch of dots. And then a lot of tension into going into something that was much looser, much more expressive. Because this is expressive. Scrimshaw was not expressive. That was pretty much illustration, mostly illustration for me. But it was a good paycheck for a long time. Did I answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay.
And now I'd like to just ask you a little bit about water imagery. That in particular, it seems relaxed, meandering. It's not turbulent, say in contrast to the fiery skies or wind-whipped trees. Could you speak to water as a feature of your work?
That's a really neat thing to ask, because it is very calm water and it is reflecting. And that, I think, is showing the spiritual journey that I'm on and that everybody's on, that there's a lot of reflecting, a lot of not knowing how deep the water is, how fast it's moving, and the turbulence is up here. And that's learning to work with that turbulence is really interesting. So the upper, the clouds. I don't think I've ever done a blue sky in my life. I don't think I have. I'll do little tiny bubbles of blue maybe here and there, but the turbulence is upstairs. Uh-huh. Yeah. But this is the beginning of the series of these pieces, the larger pieces on the wall down there, and the smaller ones. This one was a thumbnail that stayed very true to the thumbnail, about that big. So I'll start with an underpainting that is pretty much this color. It's more of the peachy, and then the transparent orange would add. So it wasn't a lot of additive color to this. But I love the lavender, working with warm and cool. It's just so much fun. This, of course, had one layer of pretty much the warm color, and then adding the lavender after that, and then cutting through with my finger. It's mostly my finger it's always my finger that's doing this, that's doing the accents at the end. That is what I usually do when I'm feeling really done. This one came very quickly, and I was very happy when I did this painting because I was worried about the shapes and the horizon line. Did I want to do anything that represented something that was a harder edge of a, let's say, a hill or just a line here? And I said, no, just kind of merge them. So this ended up being the real focal point, was this. And I really enjoyed that. This painting is a pure joy, and I'm just so glad that it sold, because it's one that really means a lot to me. It was the beginning of something that is, I think, doing what I want it to do. And this is one of those that was able to stay the edges moving, workable, so I could drag the brush and make these lines either going up or down into the water. And I really like our office manager, Margaret, used this in so many different ways, where she used a composition for, I think for this talk, was this cut off here. And so she created so many neat ideas to be able to continue with the series by creating some other really abstract compositions. So this one is representative of what I really wanted to have happen for this show specifically, was this piece. This is the beginning of it. So did I answer your question, David? Was there another one that you wanted me to focus on, or?
If you'd like.
Let's see. This is a piece that was started, I guess, a couple of years ago. There was a piece that was similar to it. This one is interesting because of the nature of really not knowing where you are. And I really wanted to keep it that way. Some people would say, oh, is this a waterfall? No, it's just a shape that ended up being water and makes no, from a physics point of view, makes no sense with where it's coming from and where it's going. And I really like that. And whether this is dirt, whether this is field, yes, these are trees. Yes, you can tell this is some kind of a background. You're not quite sure. It says hill. But I think what I like most is its simplicity and really not knowing where you are, being grounded, and being able to experience being in a landscape. So this one I thought was very successful that way. And then again, cutting into the surface where underneath here, this is the ground's color, was this, I guess I would call it kind of a mauve-y color that isn't really showing up besides here, but this was the underpainting color cutting through here. And I just love doing that. It's so much fun. But, so I think that's good.
We have some questions, yes.
Is it the first painting that you talked about? I wonder if you could talk about the sequence of which colors you put down first. Did you put down the dark ones first and then...
The first one I was referring to?
And then there's some turquoise that's coming through, and I wonder at what point the turquoise was laid down.
The turquoise here? The warm color was the ground for the entire surface of the painting, and then doing the darks. That's what I always do, doing the darks, the indigo-esque, because I create all my darks. I'll start with whether it's a cool or a warm. This is a pretty cool dark. So yes, and then I'll go in here and just make this outline and make this river shape, which ended up being river shape really quickly. I really like Prussian blue and phthalo blue because when you get the orange next to it, it has a beautiful edge of turquoise when you start running into it. This is, to me, just one of the most successful parts of the painting is this part because it has so many different lives to it depending on what you decide to merge it with. And then the skies usually last, but then I'll futz with it. And knowing that, yes, because this needs to be somewhat drier in order to wipe through it, in order to have this be some of the reflective areas in the sky to make the piece cohesive. If this were blue, it wouldn't work in the sky. And then the turquoise, some of these turquoise bits were ones where they ran into each other and became more evident, but I decided to add a tiny, tiny bit right there where I added it on top. This was part of this turquoise that was within the paint, which was the phthalo blue and the Prussian blue, especially down here. I love this part. This is so groovy. And then this purple that is just so clean, one layer, and yet it's more purple than the rest of, as I go up here, it goes more reflected to the sky, and a little bit more ochre yellow gets added in as I go up. Did I answer your question, Naomi? Mm-hmm. Okay.
Petey, I'm comparing the two, which you love so much, and the one behind David, which is a lot more contained, less abstract.
So you're talking about the big one on the wall?
No, I'm talking about the smaller one that David is looking at right now.
Uh-huh.
They seem to be of a different category or a different...
There's a lot more layers of paint on this one.
More layers?
Oh, yeah. I really, really struggled with this painting. I didn't feel I was in a weird space. I just couldn't get the shapes to work. There was just a lot. I was working with it a lot longer. And so I think that, to me, it shows, too, and the show's struggle, and maybe that can affect people in a negative or a positive way. There's more spontaneity in that one than there is in this one. Different kind of spontaneity, because there's lots. I love wispy edges on trees. I thought that was really successful. This is, I think, successful. I think this is successful, too. But that was more spontaneous and more, with less struggle, more of an exhale. I had to go for a while with this one before I was done.
Allowed you to feel that when you were doing that one? What was stopping you?
That was a day, I think, that I was just going into the studio where you just feel crappy and you just know that you're on a deadline, and people that know me pretty well know that I try to get a lot done in a short amount of time. Although the thumbnails are there, and that's where I feel an awful lot of my work is done, when I feel like I have something that I'm going to be jumping into with the thumbnails. I have a lot of thumbnails of this particular piece, though. It morphed a lot. And it's square. Square sometimes can be really... Yeah, well, that one's square, too. Same size, actually. But I was just in a rugged space. I felt a lot of pressure the week or two that I was working on this one.
I think it works, though.
Well, that's good. I'm glad.
Let's say two more questions, and then you haven't asked any yet. Go ahead.
Are you still working? I always want to be in your paintings. There are always places that I would like to go to. And I'm wondering what your relationship is when
you finish a painting and you've made a place that is beautiful, and how you relate to that. I mean, it maybe they they're not real places, but it's as if they become real places. And do you spend a lot of time looking at your paintings when you finish them and finding things in them and falling in love with the place you've made?
I am now, because this is a sole location where I'm marketing my work now, so I'm around them more. When they used to get shipped off to galleries, they would be gone generally, and I wouldn't usually see them again. So I'm feeling now like they're children that are around me longer, and I'm really enjoying that a lot. Sometimes it's really scary, and I have to turn them to the wall, turn it around, and go, do I really want to tweak that? It's already titled. But I'll tweak it. I'm sure everybody does. But anyway, yeah, I love having them around, and they're. It's interesting having a gallery marketing your own work in that sense, because I'm around them more.
Seems like a nice development.
It's very trippy. It's really quite amazing.
But. We'll get to that shortly. Yes, sir.
Yeah, Pete, you're telling us that these paintings have a darkness, that they come from darkness, but they seem more like dreamscapes rather than...
The two really dark ones I was referring to?
I mean, they don't say fear and stress and longing, loss. Those are some of the words that you seem to have used, except for longing. And yet, they just seem like dreamscapes, whereas these others are fantastical. Like
a
fantastical interpretation of the natural world. Can you talk about whether things occur to you in a fashion where you're pulling away out of something deep? I mean, that you did say does that, but what about the orange? I mean, where did that come from in the mauve and purple and so forth?
The color palette in the really bright pieces, there's a lot of energy. It's a lot of energy, and there's a lot of resolved energy in them. In other words, they know where they're going. And there's not as much question, it's just, okay, let's just work on this now, and let's just keep on doing it. I like this. I mean, this is me talking to myself. I love the colors working against each other in the orange. I love this also. I've done probably more in this kind of a palette sense than the really bright ones, I think. Maybe it's just that I'm just remembering them because they have so much emotional material connected to them. These weren't necessarily going to be ending up being as dark as they were, but they did. They ended up being that dark. And so there's just a lot of struggle between, a lot of paint came off. I don't usually do that very much, but I said, I really, really want this composition to work. So I struggled with it, took all the paint off, and then jumped back into it, probably 3 times. And I rarely do that. It's going to be neat listening to this video and see how many times I contradict myself. But that I remember that was so much the struggle, because I really do enjoy being able to feel somewhat decisive and get the paint going and have it feel resolved. So there was a lot, and in the same piece, the same thing happened. But they end up being the ones that I'm around the longest, that I'm most emotionally attached to, because there's so many layers of material and paint. Paint came off, and the paint that went back on. And Jim can vouch for it. I just was crying my eyeballs out, was saying, I don't really want to let go of these two. And then so what came out of it was that one. So I just said, okay, Pete, let's work with a similar color palette, kind of, but keep some of the brightness within it. Do what you really love to do. Do a river, but then work with some of the issues that were happening within this one and that one.
And that one?
No. That one doesn't seem to have as much, because it had really brightness, a lot of brightness from the beginning, and didn't come off and go back on. It wasn't reworked and reworked. This one was. And this one, the paint kept on sinking, and there was a lot of, just a lot of memories of something that has anything to do with dark hills and dusk or dawn for me, and maybe for a lot of us, but and South Pond, if it's a specific place. Hi, Maisie.
I'm going to say something very elementary, but it appears to me as though, as a point of view, the placement of the viewer is over the landscape most of the time in these, what you would call yet, the brilliant ones, and I'm flying over them, and some, I'm flying.
Is that called an aerial view?
You're interested in birds. And I'm wondering, I feel as if I'm on a migration.
That's cool, I like that.
Well, I'm this sort of person that I sort of have to get into the painting. Mm-hmm. And it takes me a while to feel what the viewer might actually feel flying over these landscapes. Some of them look like Mars. the water on Mars.
Point about
but
the artist's point of view. Go ahead.
The point of view, and I think in art you have to feel your perspective. You know, and you've got it. But I feel more grounded in the darker ones, and I think that's where you've come to land in a sense on the Rockwell-like. Dublin Lake, but it isn't Dublin Lake, but it's the lake. You're on the lake, and you're almost on whatever river this is. It's misty, but kind of feeling your way down into something.
Interesting, Maisie, yeah, because you are, you does feel like
just
you're on the shore, and you're right in your environment,
yeah,
as opposed to above it looking down.
Yeah.
Maybe that's why it was
so
hard.
Very interesting when you said about the journey, because that's... That's what we do.
Yeah.
I'm
great.
Sorry, I'm not trying to be a bird, but
no, I thought that was great.
Puts you in that role.
Yeah. Thanks.
I was struck, Petey, you were talking about Margaret taking images of that, and you used the word series. Do you work in series? Do you how does that why did you use that word?
Because I guess that's the proper word to use, I suppose, because they're the images that are staying somehow cohesive and similar. When I do my thumbnails before I get ready for a show, which is so much fun to look back on them, that there's a whole mess of these different ways of doing all these angles and these clouds, and horizon line is a total trip on its own. Just getting really either low or not having a horizon line at all. But anyway, series, yeah, I guess that's the word of what it is that I'm doing specifically with the brighter river paintings. Mm-hmm. Or paintings with rivers in them where you don't know where they're ending up, which one never does anyway.
And has that always been your way, that you'll work through whatever thoughts you're having about a particular composition, and you'll continue to work that until you've satisfied, and then you move on to some other considerations, or you just go and...
I think you're making me think about things I haven't really thought about. but I think I continue to do this particular kind of composition because it relates to what it is for me to be human, with traveling and whether there's a brightness around it, whether there's a... so I guess it's a container and a way for me... Container's the wrong word. What's the word? A vehicle? For me to be able to work through my life. So whether it's landscape or not, whether I were purely an abstract painter, I would probably still do these diagonals. But it's the I don't know if I answered that question, but I'm liking the way it's making me start to think about, boy, these artist talks are great, because you really get to talk about and see in front of a whole mess of people what it is that, and I'm a videotape so you can see it again, what it is that you're thinking, getting inside your brain. Everybody should do this.
Can I ask a question related to that?
Yeah.
I'm watching this and realizing we're all putting our own individual interpretations onto things and then putting words onto things, but I'm sitting here looking at you wondering, when you're actually doing these, are you putting as many words on these things as we are? Are you thinking all of the stuff that we're thinking, or is there an actual different, perhaps less word process going on for you, and then you present them to us, and our minds start going and putting labels and thoughts and impressions on things? And I'm not saying that in judgment towards you or us, but is it strange for you at times to do something and know where you were feeling, what you were experiencing when you were doing it, and then bringing it out and all of a sudden having a room full of people? I mean, I've heard you several times say, gee, I didn't think about that, or gee, or actually having a hard time even putting words to some of this stuff. And I've never quite understood that until tonight, where I'm wondering, maybe that's because we all put words onto things that you're not necessarily putting on. You're experiencing more than...
Yeah, it's an emotional experience. There are no words going through me at all when I'm painting. Not at the time. Let's say if I'm trying to figure out what color might work, I'm not saying, okay, indigo blue with cadmium orange. Or I'm not doing that. I'm not thinking, oh my God. I'm very, let's say the dark ones, which there was a lot of pain. There was just the feeling in one's gut, in my gut. It wasn't anything having to do with, oh my God, that experience with A, B, or C in my life created the pain that is coming out through my color choice or my compositional choice. I'm not working with words at all.
So is it strange bringing it out to the world and then having everybody present you with words?
Oh God, I love it, because it brings it to a different intimacy with the people that are experiencing it, because that's how we experience. We talk. We use words to be able to figure out our responses to things as humans. It'd be great to, yeah. I'm loving it. It's a necessary part of the evolution and the maturity of these works are to be seen and to have conversations about and for them to live with other people, live with mama for a while and maybe come back and then go and be somewhere else.
Maybe I just don't remember. Could you talk to us about why there are no figures, no human presence or human activity in any of your work, even though I try to put them in there?
Or in this body of work, right? People are surprised when they see there was a painting that I had up that was of my studio. I don't know if anybody remembers of it. It was very ethereal and muted, and that was very personal, doing that. But it feels, it's not something that I think about with words, but they just feel, humans feel besides the point. And humans are here, you just don't see them. They're somewhere within here, I'm sure, but they're not depicted. Because it's about the earth, and we're all part of the earth, and I'm not, even though I did study the human form, and create a lot of works having to do with the human form and animals, a lot of animals. I've been very true to that. I have very rarely done even stone walls. Sorry. But I have, and I'm attracted to rock. But it doesn't seem to be something that's specific in my life.
I don't want to put words in your mouth, but what would you, could you say that you're not necessarily excluding humans and human activity, but they're not part of the expression? In a sense, without seeing other humans, the relationship exists between you and the image, And if that's true, how do you want the viewer to enter into your work?
I can't control that.
Do you even think about it?
No. Mm-hmm. No, I don't. It just happens and people respond to it.
Not since the scrimshaw days.
Well, those were...
I'm kidding.
Commissions and things like that. But no, I don't think about it. I think about color and shape, and it very often is something that the other people have experienced in the landscape. It's calming. And it's also really in your face and exhilarating and can create fear. But I don't... not quite sure why I don't have humans. It's not that they don't fit in. We're all part of our environment. We all came from it. I have to think about that.
In this case, we're flying above it anyway, so.
I have to think about that.
But do you ever do commissions?
Oh, yeah. I haven't for a while.
And so how is that process different? Because there, you know, you've got a viewer. You've got someone who wants something from you, mm-hmm. and your economic life depends on being able to deliver that.
Mm-hmm.
And so how is that different than work on spec?
Yeah. It's I just finished a commission that took me a long time to do. And the assignment didn't bother me, but I didn't know whether the placement of certain parts of the landscape were what that person wanted because the person was not here. So I just decided to take my own artistic license. But there was a lot of insecurity working with it. But for many years before I did, the people would just give vague ideas of what they would want with mountain and river doing this and this color scheme having to do with landscape. And that was
fine. As specific as that?
Yeah, that it was fine. They would see bodies of my work and say, "Ooh, I like something kind of like that, but can there be a row of trees of specifically
people,
hemlock?
A family portrait, the picnic or something?"
Nobody's asked me to have a picnic table with the kids and the dogs within a landscape, and I think I probably wouldn't. I saw a hand somewhere.
If you have something you want to say, make a note, just so you remember it. So yes, go ahead. Well, I'm sorry, David.
I want to ask about orange. Could you tell me about your relationship to orange?
So David, you want to know about my relationship to orange?
It's not too intimate.
It's a color that gives me a lot of joy, and sometimes it does connect with the landscape. Not all the time. Yeah, I know, David, but I do it anyway. but I love it because it's a color that I can use in large areas and can still read as landscape and then use its complement and then really make it full of tension. And sometimes the tension can be pleasant, sometimes the tension is not pleasant. But there's a lot of movement and energy and tension. And I think that that's okay. I enjoy it. Did that make sense, David, to you?
Yeah, do you dream in orange?
I don't dream in color. I don't think I ever have.
Go ahead, sir.
I heard you use the word attach once. And I'd really like to hear you address your personal attachment to your work.
Personal attachment. The attachment is mostly when I'm remembering that there was a real struggle. I seem to attach to the struggle piece. I'm not attached to I'm not really attached to all the joy that went into this very first one because it was It wasn't like this. It was, oh, go for it. Yeah, I'm moving with you, girl. And then it gets done. The attached part, I guess a lot of it has to do with when there's a painful experience, we seem to attach more to something that's painful. I should speak for myself. I do, and so I work with that more. So if I'm answering your question at all, the attachment of something that was really needing to be reworked and reworked and reworked is a memory which is painful and attaching to it. I don't know if I'm answering your question. I may not be, but okay.
Could you add in, speaking about the extremes, considering some work not a part of yourself as opposed to not wanting to sell work?
Say that again, Gary.
I would envision the extremes of you finish something and then you feel that work wasn't a part of yourself at all. There was sort of a non-attachment versus you finish your work and you don't even want to sell it.
I don't think I've ever not wanted to have a piece move on. Because they're it's the process, and then it goes somewhere else, and then the continuum of creating new works, and just it's the process and not having them around. That's what's so interesting about the having the gallery, that they're around me more. I'm trying to figure out whether that's helping me enjoy painting more or the opposite. I think I'm starting to enjoy painting more, and that's a big deal for me.
Let's take two more quick questions here, and then we're going to move on to the next topic. Why don't you go ahead, and then you.
Thank you. Speedy, you've talked a lot about the emotional process of doing a painting and anxiety and fear and things, you know, how is it going to work out? And you've talked about sometimes turning something to the wall and then coming back to it, but I haven't heard you say anything about abandoning something and moving on. Do you ever get to that point where you can't see it being a success and you move on? And if so, what does that letting go feel like?
That's getting a lot easier. Yeah, and that happens often. Yeah. Especially with moving to another studio where you go through and you're putting things against the wall and you go, oh, I get to see you again. But just knowing that's I'm being easier on myself also with that, because they're just paint being moved around at a time where I was in that place at that time, and that's all the past. So I think that I'm coming to peace with that more. And yes, there's a lot of pieces that I don't finish. Yeah.
So you mentioned that these two dark pieces they were painful. They came from a place of pain. Is this your initial sort of resolution of that pain, or is there a reconciliation by doing the painting? Where is it in that process of you dealing with the pain?
There's definitely a reconciliation, and it was started in a place of mourning.
Okay.
Both of those, and loss and missing, and that came through with the amount of paint that's there, where, again, removing and putting back on. In other words, not being clear about where I'm going with it. But, yeah, they were started in a place that was real mourning. I mean, this is reminiscent of South Pond, that has a lot of memories with people that I still love that are not on the planet anymore. But and that's so interesting. Maisie, were you the one that said that one is... Yeah, on the ground. I'll remember that forever. Yeah, but sorry, David, did I answer your question?
Okay. I'm just curious in terms of the birth order. The two darker Somerset Reflections and Flowing West, in this body of work, what's their birth order?
You mean in relation to this body
Everything
of work or
else.
Each other?
No, well, that and this body of work.
these two were blocked in and really started when I started all of the brighter river pieces. And pretty much the last piece in the show that was delivered wet, that when I started to have the resolve with these two dark ones, that's when the hard vertical came in. And I said, okay, we're making progress here with being able to combine the sadness and the joy. And that's pretty much what that painting represents. But so these were blocked in, very blocked in. I don't think that they were, yeah, they have been blocked in for a long time.
Blocked in means this one, you had it sort of laid out. But
this one here especially, yeah. And couldn't get the shapes to work and all of that. But these guys, the ones with the orange and the brighter colors, were ones that flowed more easily.
Is that called Roan orange?
We'll call it Roan orange now.
So now a little bit of sort of practical matters. So with regard to this body of work, do you generally determine in advance of a show how many paintings you want to have for a given space and then work toward that? Or does work get started and then abandoned, as you've sort of indicated it does? Let's just go with the first part of that. When you're getting ready for a show, do you consider the space and consider the number of pieces you want to have for that space and then work toward that?
It's an idea that's over here of how much I'll be needing. But pretty much I'm just wanting to get the painting going and then choose from whatever it ends up being done. And it's kind of a push and pull, knowing the size of the space and knowing that there were one or two that already existed or almost done, and say, okay, if I put those in, that can work there and there, and then whether it's a cohesive body of work and statement. It's a push and pull. I'll start a lot of work. There's probably another 8 in the studio that if I had a few more weeks, I would have had more to choose from. There's a lot more work that are in a couple of these series that could have been mm-hmm. in here. Mm-hmm. But I had to, there was a choosing place where, okay, do I have one more day? I was painting until the day before the hanging.
So in terms of speaking about actually hanging the show, how do you select the completed works to show? I think you've sort of...
Mm-hmm. It's still fine-tuned up until the day of.
Yeah.
Even though the titles all have to be in, all the images have to be shot, because there's a timeline that you have to deal with that. But
but you have in mind, or do you have in mind, rather than make a statement, I'll pose this as a question, do you have a sort of an overall concept or a valence that you wish to create in the works that you choose, or do you choose them according to that's successful, I like this one, this will, yeah, this is okay, but they don't necessarily coalesce as a whole, or no, you don't do that, you've got a sort of a story almost in mind?
It's a combination of all of that, because I, up until maybe 2 days before, then maybe 3 days, these two guys were not resolved. The two dark ones were not resolved yet. And I just was clinging like mad. I really wanted them in. And they're really different. But it reminded me when I had a show in Boston with the New Fine Arts, and every single painting had the same amount of saturated cadmium in it. And I didn't really see that it was such an overbearing amount. But I didn't have any distance from it at all. But I was seven, it's so much fun. But then I realized I really should have curated that show better. Mm-hmm. So it's a maturing, it's a process. So I'm glad that there is variety, and I'm glad that there is conversation about, this one's so different, I respond to this one, I don't respond to that. And that's great, because I had done several shows that had too much of the same thing happening. And there is a same with a lot of this. But at least there's some tweaking, there's some variety, and it's not like this is a survey, it's a tiny show. But did I answer your question?
I feel satisfied, yes. And then more specifically about hanging the work. Mm-hmm. Is there a sense of how you want to tell the story, or are you thinking about individual pieces in an individual spot?
What's really funny, when I brought the work down, I wanted to bring it down late at night just because it's so easier to do it under cloak of darkness, have my truck by myself, and Jim helped with bringing the work down at 10:30 at night, and I said, okay, Jim, I need to be alone. So the first place where I put them, these are exactly where they got hung. There was no forethought, really. They were just, I don't think we tweaked it at all, did we, Jim? No, it just, and then you came back in the next day, and I said, Jim, it's done. Right, that's right. Yeah, and we deleted a few pieces, so we put the small ones up. But they're that's just how it happened, so I was really happy. It's not like it's a huge show, but there is a conversation and a need for balance. And I think it worked out okay, I think.
Given the financial constraints that art practice inflicts upon nearly all practitioners, why have you continued at this?
Because it really is challenging, and I really like a challenge. It's so hard to do. And I love that people respond to it. It's a conversation with my community, my internal community and my external community and my spiritual life. It's a way of having a conversation with yourself and with others. And I didn't know until not too many years ago that I really didn't have an ability. I didn't know I had abilities to do something else. Because connecting with people and the emotional content is really what makes my socks go up and down. And so this is my vehicle with connecting
Your
with people.
Your socks go up and down?
Yeah, you know, excitement.
Okay.
You don't know that term? Nobody knows that term, socks go up and down?
It could be a suffering expression, yeah. They say that in Suffern, New York.
Yeah, really.
Pain and suffering.
Yeah.
Don't make me snort.
Additionally, you live with an artist. What's that been like? And how long have you guys been together? This is a cluster question, so how involved are you with each other's work in terms of problem solving, complaining, mutual sounding board? And how does the activity of daily life get done?
Now? It's different now. Jim and I guess about 18 years ago, shared my studio when we were at 127 or at a Crossing River Gallery School. Little tiny space. It was, learning tolerance. We had a really tough time, but we were still very much in love with each other, and we did it for a year. And then, so, I left the studio. it's real, we don't discuss each other's work I don't know any creative people, maybe you guys do, that regularly discuss their creative work, what they're doing. Hey, come see what I'm doing in the studio, regularly. We do every once in a while, but not very often, right? Right. And we don't do it that often, but when we do, it's so genuine and so real because we both have really good eyeballs for seeing things, and so therefore they're always fresh if we see each other's work. Maybe this is a lesson. Maybe we should do that more. But so we don't do it very often. So what is it like to be married to another partner? We've been together we had our 20th anniversary this year, and we got married at the museum, which seems like a really fun thing because, you know, art, marriage, partners. And we get up in the morning and tend our animals, and that's our absolute love and our gardens, and that's what we love to share, and that's a really wonderful balance with having our studios there and in town and now having this child that is suckling away. So the morning is just a wonderful time together with the animals, and we love that equally, I think. Did I answer your question?
Mm-hmm. Anyone then want to pursue this any further? Jim, would you come up here, please? You probably should stand over there.
Hi.
Good job.
A little over a year ago, you and Jim opened Mitchell Giddings Fine Art. The amount of physical, mental, and emotional capital that such a venture has required, not to mention the sheer mountains of time, would seem to preclude any art making whatsoever. And yet, on the walls around us, we see evidence to the contrary. Please explain yourselves in such a way that we will be convinced that you're not out of your minds.
Who are you directing the question to?
You're both in it.
I have no way of convincing anybody that we're not out of our minds. Because I think in my introduction, as brief as it was, what I tried to convey is how difficult this has been. And the amazing thing to me is how much work Petey's been able to do. It's a matter of organizing time like we've never been able to, never had to before. And we're finally getting there. We still haven't had our chance to sit down, me and Petey and Margaret, and decide how do we make our time work better. And usually what happens is somebody gets kicked out, Petey gets kicked out so that she can paint. And I take over, and now the same thing is being reversed because I've got a show that opens in 2 weeks, and I've got to start painting. So
start.
Jim, you better go now, man.
I got supper first. I've got a few things going, but so the shoes have been reversed. Petey is kicking me out.
Your socks are going up and down?
Yeah, they've gone down. They haven't come back up. But it's seriously, it's been really difficult, and we're trying to make it work. And as long as we can keep some of the painting in there and keep the gallery going, that's good. The balance is still being worked on.
I think the balance is, he's ditto.
Yeah,
there we go. Yeah, ditto. But I think that we're really starting to find, I actually should speak for myself. I think that we really are starting to find a balance of how we are learning to use our time really wisely. And I think that's a wonderful exercise anyway. But knowing what floats to the top of what we do with every breathing moment is just so important, with how we spend our time with our friends and our family and our nonprofit lives. And that to me is a real gift, because it had to become a really acute awareness because of doing this, because this is such a huge give back to the community. But we get back also because we see people really enjoying the space. And it was really, really hard to get myself out of here and get to the studio. It was probably the hardest thing I've probably ever done, because I wanted to be here. But I'm not saying that I enjoyed the pressure, and I'm used to working under pressure, but that kind of pressure I don't think I've ever felt before. And I think that these two guys are, again, where it shows some of the insecurity I was going through, but.
Jim, anything more?
No, I think that says it. I just am amazed at the amount of work that Petey did, just the physical amount of, the amount of laying paint down and making it work, mm-hmm. Is really fairly awesome. And and it all comes out into a beautiful show.
Thanks, Jim.
So I guess then the question is, are we convinced? Thank you all. Yeah. Thank you, guys. Yeah.